going to do mighty things through the church. And Father, I'm glad that we've assembled together today to be in your house, to be unified together, to commit unto reaching the world for Christ. Lord, I'm thankful for the members of our church and the folks that have committed their life to you, that we might be able to do a work for you, Lord, that you get all the credit for it. It'd be so supernatural that we could never get any credit for it. Father, I do pray for you to do that. Pray that you speak to our hearts right now, Lord. Just give us something from the Word of God. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing. I want you to, we're just going to kind of look at this. I want to get somewhere with this. I want to get to where we're going. But I want to explain to you what's happening here. Peter, or Simon Peter, Jesus named him Peter. That's where he got the name Peter from. His name was Simon. And Peter was the name God gave him, which meant little rock, Petra. And Jesus was the rock, the big rock. And so he named him Peter. And then Peter, describing himself, says a servant. And I've talked about this many times in our church, maybe not in a while. But that word servant there means bond slave. It means, that's exactly what he was saying. He says, listen, I'm a slave to Jesus. That's what I am. I serve him and I truly serve him. And Paul would often refer to himself as the same servant. And Jude referred to himself as the same servant. And they were enslaved to the Lord Jesus Christ. You understand, we don't have slaves anymore. But when people did have slaves, the slave did exactly what the master wanted. And in Bible times, when they had slaves, they were poor. And there, some of them were lucky to become the slave of somebody so that they could be taken care of. I'm not talking about the slavery we had here in America years ago. I'm talking about a different form of it. And so Peter was trying to get down on the level with them. He said, listen, I'm a bond slave. I'm a servant to Jesus Christ. And then he said, I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ. The word apostle means messenger. And he was a God-called messenger. That's what an apostle is. There are no apostles now. I don't care what some of these folks say on TV and what some of these church signs say around here, as I've seen them, apostle so-and-so. It is not true. There are no more apostles. Apostle had to meet Jesus personally. And Paul met Jesus personally on the Damascus Road and also spent 3 years with him in Arabia. He was an apostle. And then there are some generic uses of it in the Bible where others that had not met with Jesus personally were called apostles because of some other reasons. I don't want to get into that. But the main thing was Peter was saying, look, I'm a servant and I'm a slave to the Lord. And in a good way. And that's what I want to be. I want to be a servant to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And do exactly what he wants me to do. I don't want to have my own thoughts. A slave does not do what he wants to do. He does what the master says. And that's what I want. That's what God wants for us. And then he says he's an apostle of Jesus Christ. But then look at it. To them that have obtained the like precious faith. To them that have obtained like precious faith with us. What's he saying? All you folks that got saved like I got saved. Now he's writing to them. I'm a slave. I'm a servant. God's called me to be a messenger. I'm writing to you that have the same kind of faith I have. The same kind of beliefs I have. The same kind of faith you put into God. This is the same kind of faith I put into God. That lets me know, listen, that's a good thing right there, because we do have the same God Peter had, and we've got the same God Paul had, and he's got the same power they had, and we have it. And it says, I'm writing this to those who have a like precious faith and obtained it, like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God. What does that mean, Brother Burton? Listen, we did not get the faith because of anything we did. We got faith because God, being a righteous God, a perfect God, and the righteousness of God and of our Savior, Jesus Christ. We have the like precious faith that Peter had. How did we get it? We got it through Jesus. We got exactly what he has. And that's a blessing. But then I want you to notice verse number 2 and 3, and that's where I want to be at today. The next word is grace. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and our Lord, and our Jesus, and of Jesus our Lord. Grace and peace. Now, I said this morning that grace is unmerited favor. It's the favor we get from God, and we don't deserve it. We didn't do anything for it. Everybody listen to me now. This ain't a long message. You've got to get what I'm going to give you in a short time. He said, well, I'd rather you preach a long time and give it to it. No, I'm not. There's nothing you can do to make me do it. All right, whatever. All right. And so, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Or whatever it says there at the end, how they ordered it. Now listen to me. That word grace there is not saying unmerited favor and peace be multiplied to you. We already got that. We're saved. God gave us unmerited favor and saved us, and He still gives it to us constantly. But grace there, if you look it up, means this. Now listen to me now and put this in your head and try to get where I'm going now. The divine influence upon the heart that reflects in your everyday life. That's what he's saying. Grace there, you studied out in the Strong's or in the dictionary, the Strong's, which would be the Greek word there. The divine influence upon the heart that reflects in your everyday life. The divine influence upon the heart that reflects in the everyday life. Divine influence, what's that? God's influence. That reflects, that's upon my heart, and that reflects in my everyday life. What people see that God has given me. What God has done for me that is good, and that it reflects in my everyday life. And people see the reflection of God in my everyday life. People see what God did in my heart and what He's doing in my life, in my everyday life. That's what grace is. You say, well, you know, I know a lot of people that need more grace. I need grace every day. God, grace me. Give me grace today, Lord. Help me to have that divine influence that reflects from my heart in my everyday life. And listen to me, folks. Nothing greater than grace. Nothing greater than unmerited favor.
Yeah.
But there's also nothing greater than that divine influence that is upon our hearts that reflects in our everyday life. If we're going to do anything for God, it would have to be acting like God.
Yeah.
Being godly. Well, how do we do that? The divine influence upon the heart that reflects in our everyday life. The divine influence. And Paul said, or Peter says here, grace and peace. Listen, that word peace there literally means Jesus woven into you. The word peace literally means, I hate to go Greek all the time, I'm not trying to do that, but I study those words out, and it means interwoven. That it's woven into you. The divine influence upon the heart reflects in your everyday life, plus Jesus and who He is and what He is woven into your life, weaved in there where it won't come out. He says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Now listen to me, folks. You say, Brother Burton, I know where you're going. I know what you're going to say. Well, I think when God sees that we're all doing it and we don't need it anymore, God will say, Burton, don't say it no more. Yeah. See, you think you know God like that? I sure hope I do. I want to say what God wants me to say. I don't sit up there and think about everybody's problems and go, man, I need to preach something like this. I've done it very rarely. And there's nothing wrong with me doing that every now and then, but I want what God wants. And so, He says, the like precious faith through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ, grace be unto you, and grace and peace be multiplied unto you. How's it going to get multiplied? Listen, when I have a money problem, I like to add to my money. I like addition, but I really like multiplication a lot better. I'd rather see a lot of money get multiplied than to see it get just a little added 10 here and 10 there. I want to see it multiplied by 10. And he says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you. How? Through the knowledge of God.
Yeah.
And through Jesus Christ. Well, where do we get that at, Brother Burton? We get it from the book. So I don't understand the book. When I was a young Christian, I didn't understand the book either. What'd you do, Brother Burton? I usually called him. And then they put me on little books, concordances and dictionaries and Bible programs. And then I studied. And I learned. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God. Approved unto God. Listen, if you don't study, you can't be approved unto God. Study, show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed. If you can't answer God the questions from the Bible, then you ought to be ashamed. But if you study to show yourself not show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And I want grace. I want the divine reflection. I also want God to give me what I don't deserve. And God does that every day, every single day. I deserve a lot worse. And I don't deserve nearly the good that I get. What's that? That's God's grace. He's very gracious to me. Gives me more than I ever would have dreamed. But also I got to have that divine reflection upon the heart that reflects the divine influence upon the heart that reflects my everyday life. How are you going to get that? Well, folks, in 2015, we're going to get it through the Bible.
Amen.
That's it. Man, how many of us have, don't raise your hands or nothing, but how many of us have resolved to say, I'm going to read this Bible this year? You know, 3 chapters a day and 5 on Sundays, you read it through in a year. And what I've decided is I'm going to read it, but I'm not going to study it in that time. Because I get bogged down sometimes by the point. I get to seeing stuff, wait a minute, I'm going to study that out. And then I don't finish reading. I do all my studying all day and I didn't read. But I'm 3 a day, 5 on Sunday. There's a good thing on these phones we have. It's called YouVersion. Gives you versions of how to read your Bible through and tells you what to read every single day. I'm going to read it. Why? Because I want grace and peace to be multiplied unto me. Through the knowledge of God, knowing who He is. Then it says, according. Now listen to me, we're done. According as His divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. Now listen to me now. According as His divine power, God is God. He gave it to us. Because He gave it to us, and He's given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. Brother Will, we have everything we need because of that like precious faith to live a good life and to be godly. God gave it to us the moment we got saved. It's in there. It's called the fruits of the Spirit. We get them automatically. The thing is, we have to unlock them. How do we unlock them? Through the Word of God. That's the key to the soul. The key to the mind is the Word of God. And He tells us, according to His divine power, He's given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. And then look at it. Look at the rest. Through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue. The knowledge of who? Jesus. So I just don't know. Brother, I'm just struggling so much. I just don't think I can do it. Well, then the Word of God is not true. God says He gave it all the power to us. We can do it. I was talking to Frank yesterday at the store. I said, I went to Bible college, and I prayed, God, give me my brain cells back. Give me my brain cells, Lord. I know I burned them up. And folks, I'm just amazed I can carry a conversation. Because I know guys I'm in school with that can't. One of my best friends, I talked to him, and he's a little bit spacey. So I think you're a little bit spacey. I do too, but I'm just saying. According to His divine power. Listen, there's power in the blood. But well, how's that song go, Jared? The song y'all were going to sing.
There's power.
Power in the blood.
Power in the
power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. God says, according to his divine power, gave us everything we need to live a life and a godly life. And we don't have to struggle with it. And I'm talking to the choir now. I'm talking to all the folks that are trying to live for the Lord and do right. And listen, I understand that. But let me ask you this. Are you going to do it this year? Or are we just going to remain the same, go through the motions? Or are we going to get God's divine power upon us through the knowledge of Him, that grace and peace get multiplied? I mean, how many people got peace so much it's just multiplied? You're just taken back. You're so peaceful. It's just nothing can throw you for a loop. Nothing. Great peace have they which love thy law, nothing shall offend them. They, you know, we use that one a lot. You have a problem, but no, great peace have they which love thy law, nothing shall offend them. No, great peace have they which have the knowledge of God. And listen to me, that's where we're going to have to be. This is just a little charge. I know we're all tired, and I can see it in your eyes. But I want to live for the Lord.
Amen.
Man, I cannot, you know, it doesn't matter if I go charging down the street if I don't have the cavalry with me. And you're the cavalry. You're it. You're who God chose.
Amen.
And we've got to get closer to Him, and we've got to stop faking it. So why'd you say that? I don't know. But are you faking it? Because that's probably why I said it. I'm just saying, you know, I want my kids to see Daddy in the Bible, Daddy on his knees, and I want to, listen, folks, how many conversations do you have with people that you give Scripture right away, and you think of Scripture? I mean, that's how filled we are with Scripture, if we have Scripture. You talk to Pastor Pinochetti about anything. I mean, he just amazes me. Go to Zephaniah, chapter number 2. Brother Pinochetti, is Zephaniah even a book? I mean, go to Amos 1. I'm like, what? How about Matthew or something, Brother Pinochet? Something I'm familiar with. Now, we've got to get consumed with the book. My brother-in-law was in my house yesterday. He has a Spanish church. He goes, I'm getting ready to teach on the minor prophets in our church. And I'm going to take them through, man. I got this course, 13 weeks, and I'm going to take one each week and give them a background on them. He goes, I'm just going to try to teach them the history and try to teach them where they were. And that's how we'll learn. That's how the Bible comes to life, when you know what was going on. I know exactly what was going on when Peter wrote that. They were under heavy persecution. They were killing people. And Peter tells them all about the persecution. And chapter 1 tells them not to worry. And then chapter 2, he says, look, we can do it. We got it all. And he tells them this, and he says, peace, grace and peace be multiplied unto you. And I'm not going to preach this, and you're glad that I'm not. But then he says, you need to add some things to your faith. And he says, add virtue, which is moral excellence. Add to your faith virtue, and the virtue knowledge, and the knowledge temperance, and the temperance patience, and godliness, and the godliness brotherly kindness, and brotherly kindness the charity. For if these things be in you, ye shall abound. How are we going to get those things in us? Well, we have to start first with getting a divine reflection upon our heart, the reflection of our everyday life. How are we going to do that? We're going to have to get in the book.
Amen.
Folks, listen to me. I'm looking at everybody here. I know you well enough to know that if all you're doing is hearing me on Sundays and Thursdays, you're starving to death. And a lot of our kids and a lot of our parents are starving because all they're getting is me. I was good enough for the first month, and it was exciting. Some of you might even have thought, man, he was an awesome preacher that first time. But now it's time to get in the book. And it's the front of the year, man. We can make it. And Brother Paul, we're talking, we're just human. He said, I don't want to fail the Lord this year. I want to stick with it. And you know, he was looking at these things on that calendar. What was that calendar about January 17th? What was the calendar called? Yeah, January 17th is the holiday where you throw all your New Year's resolutions out the window. January 17th. And isn't that the way it works sometimes with us? You know, we commit to do stuff. But why don't we just commit something that we're not going to stop?
Yeah.
You know what I committed to do? I'm going to eat every single day. And you ain't going to stop me. Folks, I got a weed eater in the basement. I can feed my family for the rest of our lives with a weed eater. I'm going to eat every single day. There's nothing's going to stop me. I'm going to feed them every single day. Unless something tragically goes wrong and I can't get the food, which we'll eat birds, we'll eat rodents, we'll eat whatever. The rats here will feed our family well. They're big.
Yeah.
Hey, listen. Well, how come we only decide to do those things and we try to do the things of God and we are okay with failing? Some of us have already, in our minds, not sure as I thought it was going to be, but some of us in our minds have already given a way out if we can't do what we said we were going to do for God.
Yeah.
I'm going to try, but, you know, I haven't been able to do it forever. Well, how are we doing? Why do we do it? The only thing that's going to change your life is a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you don't have a relationship with Him and you don't spend time with Him, you will just do this the rest of your life. And eventually, as a Christian, you'll start doing this. You'll never go to the next level with God. And listen to me. Nobody here has arrived. Pastor Pinochetti has not arrived. Brother Guido has not arrived. I don't care who the preacher is. They've not arrived. They've got to escalate. And Paul says, or Peter says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you. I mean, you've got to think about the words now. That's unbelievable that it can be multiplied to us. Wow, man, I want to do it. Through the knowledge of God, our Savior Jesus Christ. And listen, I've given you everything you need for life. I've given you everything you need for godliness according to the divine power that according to the divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain to the life of godliness through the knowledge of Him. So, what's your final decision for people that aren't getting it? You don't want it. And you put other things ahead. We stay home from church sick and go to work. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. We've got to make money. But I'd call out of work before I stayed home from church. I mean, you know, I want God. I want the things of God to be important in my life. And I hope that God can keep them there. I don't want to worry about stuff because I want God to take care of me. And I want to, He says, prove me. Prove me to see if I won't open up a window so big that you can't even handle the blessings. Malachi 3. Man, I do. I want to just trust, just prove them. The other day, it opened up the mailbox, didn't even expect it. Well, what was in there? $500 check. What was that for? That was for some bills. I needed about $450 right now. Today, and right now, I need $450, $500 came from the mail yesterday. He said, well, that's something, man. I wish my life was like that. Well, I'm not saying I deserved it, but I'm saying I expected Him to do something. It has to be Him. Was it a missionary check? No. Nope. Now what? I bought a plane ticket, told the preacher, said, man, don't worry about it, it's about $200. He goes, well, we'll send you money. I said, you don't have to give it to me when I get there. No big deal. Said $500 instead of $200. Mm-hmm. Said, well, what's that all about? Needed $450. So I'm just telling you, man, I'm not saying money's all where it's at, but I do know God takes care of me through the divine knowledge of Him. Folks, let's make a decision right now that we won't break. You understand that everybody, and now listen to me, we're done. Everybody in here can decide right now to make a decision to grow in the knowledge and the grace of God right now. And nobody, not one person in here, has a valid excuse to ever break it. Isn't that something? I mean, there ain't nothing. And folks, unless God pokes your eyes out and makes your brain, or He cuts your ears off, you have no excuse to stop walking with God. And then if you pull your eyes out, cut your ears off, you'll do a lot of praying anyway. So why don't we just say, look, you know what? I want to grow in grace and peace. I want it to be multiplied, and I'm going for it. It's the fourth. You say, well, what happened the first 3 days? Well, if you haven't done anything these first 3 days, And I've done some things, but I could do better. Absolutely. And God just told me that, right, as I was telling you that. Then right now is a good time to start. And we make these things. Forget, you know, I'm going to lose 10 pounds in the new year. So what? And why don't you put on 10 pounds of Bible in the new year? You with me on that? I was going to preach something completely different. My wife blew that for me. I got her devotion and thought, man, that's a good thought. I'm going to preach that today. But I don't think it was God's will for me to preach that today. I think this was it. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you. So what you do? I said, I knew that verse there, and I went to it, looked at it, and said, this is exactly what we need. Now, ask yourself, do I have a divine influence upon my heart that reflects my everyday life? Is God upon my heart that everybody sees it? Because you understand, people ought to see you no matter what and think, there is something different about that person. They ought to see that. That's called grace. That's what that grace is. And it will only be multiplied through the knowledge of God, through getting to know Him better. Folks, I cannot just read 3 chapters or 5 chapters on Sunday and be fed anymore. I have to dig into the Word of God. Not that I'm a big spiritual person, but I've got to dig. I've got to dig for us. It's my responsibility to feed the church of God. And that's a big responsibility. And sometimes I think, man, if I didn't have to preach, I'd have so much free time in my mind. But I want it. And I'm glad we get it. And I feel like the Lord's going to just blow me over with messages all year. And boy, I tell you, we're just going to have to get it. Now, folks, you make a decision right now. I'm either going to do it or I'm not going to do it. That's the only two decisions you can make. You say, well, we have to make your decision. No, yeah, you do. I just gave it to you. There's no way you can't think about it. I tricked you. I'm going to do it or not do it. Or not. Well, I'm going to try. I'm going to give my all. No way. I'm 44 years old, 200 and something pounds, and I don't try to do nothing. I do it. Just like I ate this morning, just like I did what I did yesterday and the day before. And so shouldn't this be our number one priority this year? I think Jack Howells or Lester Roloff said, no Bible, no breakfast. One of them said it, or maybe it was somebody else. No Bible, no breakfast. Hey, that ought to be our priority. This last 3 days, 4 days, I said, that's all I thought about when I first looked. I got to go down there and get that Bible. I don't want to mess it up again. See, did you read your Bible a lot this year? Probably read more Bible this year than anybody, but just to study. Just to preach. See, that's not right. It's not right. I'm fine with admitting it. I'm nobody anyway. But I want to do better. And so we can do better, okay? Let's all bow our heads, close our eyes, and just can you play something. If you want to get to the Lord, you can. It's 2:30. We got time. Why don't you make a decision that will last for the Lord? Say, God, I'm trusting you to help me to get it done. You know, Jesus never fails. If we put him on the line, say, God, I've often said, God, remind me of my decisions. Don't let me forget these decisions, Lord. God wants to speak to you. And he can only do it through his written word and through the preaching of his word and through you being on your knees in unison with him. If you have iniquity in your heart, God will not hear your prayers and he cannot get to you if you have sin that you're not confessing. So what if I forgot what it is? Ask him to forgive you of what you forgot. He can do that. He knows if you forgot it or if you hadn't. Ask him to reveal it to you. Lord, is there anything in my heart right now that I need to get right with you? You know, I've never had him be quiet on that one, Monique. Never had God didn't answer me back something when I asked that one. He always has something. You come to the altar if you like to. Heavenly Father, bless now the invitation. Lord, thank you for this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Just make a decision for the Lord. Folks, we need powerhouses in God's house. We need champions for